Not entirely sure what the title of this section was called in the end. We went through a variation of different titles. So what we're going to do in this one is I'm going to do a talk about some aspects of the relationship between PDF and scholarly literature, future directions and that kind of stuff. And please feel free to interrupt, because I'd like to keep it fairly interactive. And then we can have a gunfight at the end. So rather than split out into little working groups and that kind of stuff, I thought we'd try and keep some structure to it in this kind of way. Please feel free to interrupt at any point. So I've gone with this as a title for this section, the meaning of which will become clear as the talk goes on. So it's a talk, bit of a demo, and then hopefully some room for a debate at the end. So I plan to throw in a few outrageous assertions that people can argue about. So, we'll start with the pipe. So, early on in the 19th century, René Magritte painted this, Socinus Part and Pipe. Surrealist artist, and this is the commentary that he associated with it. The Belgian accent, of course, I'm not going to do that. The famous pipe, how people reproached me for it. And yet, could you stuff my pipe? No, it's just a representation. So if I'd written on my picture, this is a pipe, I'd have been lying. So just park that in your minds for the time being, and we'll come back to that in a little bit. So one of the things that's talked about a lot in the sort of the scholarly publishing, scientific literature areas is the data deluge. So I've probably been talking for about 2.5 minutes by now. These are the papers that are likely to have been published just in the time that you've been sitting here listening to me doing this introduction. So if you're a biologist, not specifically those exact ones, roughly two papers a minute, something like that, are appearing in the literature at the moment. If you're a life scientist, you've missed six by now. By the time I've finished this little bit of the workshop, you've got this much stuff to get through. And yeah, this is a terrifying amount of stuff. Okay, so you can make the argument, of course, that no one life scientist needs to read all these papers, because these all come from different domains in the life science. So, you know, of course, you wouldn't have to read all of them. But I spoke to a colleague recently who's an epidemiologist, works in the area of obesity in particular, and he reckons that per month, in his specific field, there are something like 6,000 papers of relevance that really he would like to know about, even if it's just to say, actually, I don't need to know about the details, but I'm glad that I know about the existence of this thing. So that's 6,000 papers. And that, you know, that should scare the bejeebers out of us, really. That's an awful lot of stuff to try and make sense of. And I think it's summed up very nicely in this quote by Amos Berok. Amos Berok, one of the preeminent bioinformaticians of our age. And I'll just read the quote out, because I think it encapsulates much of modern science. It's quite depressive to think that we are spending millions in grants for people to perform experiments, produce new knowledge, hide this knowledge in often badly written text, and then spend some more millions trying to second guess what the authors really did and found. And I think, you know, there's a lot of meaning in what Berok says. So what's the problem? Is the problem the publishers? So it's very easy in our field to point the fingers at different places and say, oh, you're the problem, you know, the publishers are the bad guys, or scientists are the bad guys, or whatever. So I'd like to think about some of the factors that are influencing decisions in this space, and hopefully this is a point that we can debate later. So the publishers. So obviously things have moved on a little bit since the hand-stop cylinder printing machine, maybe not so much in other ways. I think the thing that we have to bear in mind about publishers is that for the majority of publishers, they are commercial entities. They are businesses. They are not there to serve science, they are there to serve their shareholders. So but most publishers, apart from small societies and stuff like that, but certainly big publishers are commercial entities. So their main thing is being driven by a market. They're there to serve their shareholders and to make money. And they provide a service, and that's great. And sometimes it's tempting to think that publishers are some kind of, you know, that being benefactors to science, whereas actually commercial entities. So is it the publisher's fault? Well, talk about that later. The other possibility, of course, is that it's the scientists' fault, because they're one of the other parties involved in this. So is it the scientists' fault for thinking up too much stuff? Are we just making too much knowledge? Well, that doesn't sound very likely. Making up lots of new knowledge sounds like a good thing if we had a mechanism of finding it and and understanding and making sense of it. And there's a there's a particular angle on it that I'd like to bring up here, which is, so is everybody familiar with the prisoner's, anybody not familiar with Prisoner's Dilemma? Okay, so I'll do it briefly. Prisoner's Dilemma is a bit of game theory, and the idea is that two guys have been caught doing something naughty. The police put them in separate rooms and say to them, if you defect and say that the other guy did it, then you will benefit because we will let you off and he will get a nasty sentence. If you both defect, you will both get some sentence, and if you both cooperate, you'll both get a small sentence. So if they both cooperate, they both do reasonably well. If one of them ditches the other one in, that one does really well, and the other person does really badly. If both of them ditch one another in, then they don't both do badly. And this is kind of the situation that we find ourselves in as scientists in terms of publishing. So if I decide not to publish in a high-impact journal and go for blogging or something like that on my own, then I kind of lose out, because at the moment the system doesn't credit me for that. So at the moment what I'm doing is saying, actually, my colleagues, I'm no longer competing with you, so I've made your environment slightly easier at my expense. If we all decide to not bother publishing in high-impact journals and go for blogging or some other format, then we all win. There's almost no doubt about that. But we all have to do it together. Otherwise, those who defect are the ones that win. Those who don't join in the game come out better than the people who play. And this is very much the same kind of stuff that was being talked about in this morning's keynote. Except that in this particular case, at this level of being an academic trying to make a name for yourself, there is no way directly of just breaking the system. Because if I stop publishing papers in high-impact journals, I stop being an academic because I'll get sacked in a couple of years' time. So that's the sort of the problem that we're facing at the moment. If you've made your name, if you're top professor so-and-so, then perhaps you don't have to worry about this so much. But for the majority of us in academia, it's publish or perish, whether we like it or not. And if we step out of that system, we disappear. Not instantly, but when it comes to tenure or the next promotion or whatever. So that's the situation for scientists. And then the other player in this game are the funding bodies, those who are giving out the grants and who are making decisions about promotion and keeping people in post and that kind of stuff. So what are the things that influence them? Well, they need to be able to justify what they are doing. They are also accountable to, whether it's to the taxpayer or to the charity or whatever, they are accountable in some way. So they need some kind of way of being able to guarantee that their funding has been put into meaningful places. So even if the funding goes wrong and the project doesn't work, they can say, well, we made a sensible decision to give it to this project because they had all these good metrics that made them an attractive and safe place to put it. So we did our due diligence in giving the money to somebody who has an high impact factor or whatever. And basically, they need metrics to back up their decisions. And where do the metrics come from? Well, they come from the academics and from the publishers. So we have this weird, deadly embrace where these three parties are locked into a cycle. And one of the things that I'd like to talk about in this workshop is whether there is scope for breaking that deadly embrace. Now, to get back to the main topic of this little bit of the workshop, the other thing that you can throw buns at is the PDF. So this time last year, the PDF got a bit of a kicking at Solo. So I'd like to stand in its defence to some extent, I suppose. So the PDF is the core root of all evil in scientific fiction. So these are some of the quotes that came out of Solo last year. Now, I've not attributed these, partly because I wasn't here, so I saw them via tweets, and I've not been able to get back to the originator. So if you are the originator, put your hand up and please accept my apologies for not associating them with you directly. So an insult to science. Antithetical to the spirit of the web. This one I do know. This is David Shotton, who is a friend and colleague, so I wouldn't mind using this. Like inventing the telephone and using it to transmit Morse code. And the one that gave the title to this talk, a hamburger that we are trying to turn back into a cow. And this one's associated with Peter Murray Rust, although he says that it's not his original quote, but it's one he likes to use. So, okay, fine, there are lots of problems with the PDF, but the elephant in the room is that as much as we may say that we don't like it, we all use it. 80% is conservative, I think. So lots of publishers will say that they have a higher PDF usage than 80%. And this is after having put a lot of effort into making the HTML version of their stuff richer and nicer in some slightly non-specific kind of way. But you know, a lot of effort has been put into making HTML content accessible and machine processable and all this kind of stuff. And yet what we do is we download the PDF. Why do we do this? Well, it's got a lot of nice properties. Once I've got a PDF, I can keep it on my machine, and if my university unsubscribes from a journal, I've still got it on my machine, whereas I can't get back to the website necessarily. So that's good. It's a single containable thing. It looks prettier than web pages. Okay, you can make web pages look better than PDFs, but generally they're a bit harder to read. And it also has one other nice feature which is often overlooked, which is that it stops the publisher from being sneaky and changing the paper. Because if a million people have downloaded the PDF, there's no sensible way of a publisher making a sneaky edit to it. Not that any publisher would dream of doing that, but they can't, because there are so many copies. It becomes the minutes of science. It becomes a distributed, safe version of that article, which essentially you can't change at its source because it's been replicated so many times. But it does have lots of downsides. It has, you know, it's sort of like electronic paper. It's a static format inherently. But I guess my argument is that it's not that the PDF itself is a problem. The problem is something more like this, that this is the gulf. There's humans and there's machines, and we talk completely different languages. And we need machines if we are going to manage that data deluge that I spoke of earlier. And the gulf between what makes sense to humans and what makes sense to machines is big. So let's start with some really simple concept. Okay, I've got some things, and I need to order them according to their size, smallest, first, biggest. I want to sort some stuff into order. But okay, so this is the simplest representation I can find that is amenable to a machine to do that. For all I and J that exist in the domain of S, it's true that if I is less than or equal to J, it implies that the ith element of S is less than or equal to the jth element of S. That's formal logic for stuff sorted. Unless you're really good at reading formal logic, actually getting back from those symbols to the simple statement of some stuff in order is quite tricky. And actually, a machine would find that reasonably hard to process in its own right. So it probably you'd end up with something more like this, a bit of Python for doing a sorting algorithm on that. For most people, there's no chance that anybody can write that. And that's just for a very, very simple basic statement. We're not talking about scientific assertions or any of the semantics of, you know, this protein interacts with that thing under these conditions and these kind of experiments and so on and so forth. Just a very simple concept. So the gulf between what is comprehensible to machines and what is comprehensible to humans is still not one that has been breached. So let's have a look at a few examples. So this is Mr. Tiddles. Mr. Tiddles was resting in the cozy cat bag. It's obviously an instance of the cat sat on the mat. So this is pretty much one of the most straightforward things that we can imagine representing in some kind of formal structure to a computer. So it's not beyond possibility now for a machine to take that sentence and decompose it into this kind of structure. You know, sentence, verb bit, noun bit, break it down so you end up with all these things. And a machine could make sense of this. It'll recognize the different bits of those components by looking at the different vocabularies. And we can imagine adding identifiers to these, giving a universal identifier to the concept of cat so that we can start to reason about this at a machine level. But this is still not totally trivial. So let's go to the other extreme. It's hard for me to get the intonation right this one, so I can never quite remember how it works, but I'll try. So I think it's buffalo, 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 buffalo. So this is a completely grammatically correct, semantically meaningful bit of English. Okay, so things to know to make this actually make any sense. There's a place called Buffalo, just on the border between the United States and Canada, not far from Niagara Falls. Of course, there's the animal called buffalo. And probably the least known one is there is the act of buffaloing, which is to bully or cajole. Right? So knowing those things, you can sort of make sense of the sentence. So it goes a bit like this. And if I change the words to something a bit more comprehensible, then you can see the sentence says, buffalo bison, whom buffalo bison bully, also themselves bully buffalo bison. Yeah, so buffalo, 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 buffalo. Yeah. For a machine, this is completely impenetrable without all kinds of extra hand-holding. And for a human, without quite a lot of pictures and, you know, speech bubbles. So the question is, how much of what we do and say is at the Mr. Tiddles end, and how much of it is at the Buffalo end? So are we saying, you know, things that are actually very straightforwardly comprehensible by machine, or are we saying things that are actually almost impenetrable to machine? And my guess is that it's a bit of both, that if you look at a scientific article, the methods section is reasonably formulaic. We took three of them, put them next to two of them, put a cat, warmed it up, or whatever. And it's reasonably structured, and you can imagine that with some controlled vocabularies that it might be possible to extract those. It's not possible yet in any sensible, reliable way, but it might be one though. And then at the other end, we've got results and conclusions, which are complex, inferred things, and typically with masses of hedging, because if you don't hedge yours, if you just say, I found that this does this, you won't get published. So what you say is, it may be possible that under certain circumstances, it's, you know, and that makes it much more difficult for a computer to actually understand what you're saying, and humans. But the way that we publish at the moment means that results and conclusions are actually very hard for a computer to make any sense of. So I thought I'd back this up with a couple of, well, I said real world, these are slightly historical interest kind of articles. So this is an article by Fred Sanger, the AMI Groups of Insulin, and a seminal article. It's something that's changed his part of the world, at least. It's actually the discovery of how insulin works, and it kind of goes yada 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 yada, blah 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 blah, blah. And then a few more pages, and it goes blah, 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 blah. And a bit more some stuff, blah 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 blah, and a bit more, and then it finishes. So why was this paper so influential? What made this? Because it's essentially all methods. Okay, it just says what they did. Why is this paper so influential? So the reason it's influential is in this summary, and the reason that that's important is this last sentence, which says the results are summarized in Table 7. Go back to Table 7. This is Table 7. Table 7 is a diagram, and this is the results. This is the bit that matters to a biologist, the position of the different residues in the sequence. So that's the nugget of completely opaque to a computer, because it's just now all we've got now are pixels for this. There's no semantics or meaning for this diagram. So that's, and yet this is a really good way of representing what he wanted to say. It's not that he did a bad thing by drawing it like that. That's a really good representation of what he wanted to say, but completely impenetrable to the machine. Whether that's represented on a HTML page or in a bit of PDF. At the other extreme, the Pritchett-Kell model of yeast glycolysis. So that's this thing here, which represents the relationship between different chemicals in a particular biological pathway. And all of this paper is essentially, I'm sure you'll forgive me saying, guff, describing that model. That's the bit that they wanted to publish. All of this stuff is sort of supporting stuff to make it publishable. If you just draw that picture and say, that's what we found, nobody published it. But what's interesting is what they did is they took this model and they represented it in a computer readable format. So in this case, in a markup language called SBML, Systems Biology Markup Language. Now this bit here of the diagram, this single node, takes this amount of RDF XML to describe it, and a lot of hard work. And that's just one node, let alone its relationship with the other things or any of the other nodes. So just to say, phosphenyl pyruvate exists takes, in a reliable way, takes quite a lot of hard work, a lot of manual curation. So these are the bits that kind of say that. And what it links to are other databases such that a scientist can follow from that diagram, or a computer can follow from that diagram to work out what the compounds that were involved in that particular part of their discovery were. But a massive amount of work to describe that whole model, and then you have to write a paper in order to get it published. And a final one, just because it's of sort of historical interest. So this is a very famous paper, The Molecular Structure of Nucleic Acids. So this is by Watson and Crick. So what does this paper say? Well, this is a kind of a world-changing paper in many ways. It's the discovery of the way in which genes pass on their instructions from generation to generation, because it's the one that describes how DNA works. But what does it actually say? This structure has two helical chains, each coiled around the same axis, see diagram. So that's one important claim. That's pretty much, in fact, that is pretty much the important claim. That's it. But, you know, as claims go, it's a good one. And then there are two wonderful bits of understatement. And whether or not you, regardless of all the politics surrounding this paper, there are a couple of beautiful statements in there. One of my favourites. This structure has novel features which are of considerable biological interest. Really. And this, I think, which has got to be one of the biggest scientific understatements of all times, it has not escaped our notice that the specific pairing we have postulated immediately suggests a possible copying mechanism for the genetic material. And that's where they say, by the way, this is going to change everything. But you know, not obvious what a machine would make of that. The other thing that I'd like to note about this is that is actually the full circleness of journals and letters and blogs, because we think of journals now in a particular style. They are where peer-reviewed literature goes, but they've become divorced from the original words journal, as in a book that you keep and write in. Because originally these things that we now call articles were called letters. They weren't necessarily peer-reviewed. They were letters from a scientist to a central point, which could then be distributed on horse and carts to other scientists. So it's interesting that we've sort of gone full circle from writing letters to other scientists to doing this on blogs. And somewhere in the middle we got peer review. Okay, so where's the hamburger? So is the hamburger PDF? Well, it's the problem of representing stuff, plus the complexities of language, plus the fact that computers are bad at understanding pictures. And that's what forms this hamburger that we're trying to turn back into a cow in the scientific literature. It's not the PDF file. The PDF file is just a vehicle for carrying our hamburgers around. Really. Sort of like a weird McDonald's van. And blaming the PDF is pretty much the same as blaming pen and ink, you know, or blaming language or something like that. It's just a vehicle for doing stuff with. So that's where the title of this talk came from. So this is not a hamburger. This is a scientific article. It's not the PDF. The PDF is not a hamburger. It's all of the stuff that we do as scientists that is making it very hard to span this gap between machine-readable stuff and other publishing models. So how do we improve this situation? Two possibilities: we go for revolution or evolution. So we need to change. Let's say we need to change the current publishing model, and I'm sort of asserting that it's academics, funding bodies, and publishers are the three main players in this. So the revolution is somehow we break the deadly embrace. Everybody stops doing what they're doing now, and we do something different in a massive overnight revolution. It's not clear how we achieve that. And the evolutionary one is somehow to move bits on a day-by-day basis towards the direction that we might want to go. And I think this probably means introducing more and more semantic technologies alongside the existing. How do we change the published content? Because this is another problem to make it more machine readable. The revolution one, everybody like Doug Kell in this case, everybody writes RDF instead of linear prose. Yeah, so we stop writing English and we just go for predicate logic and RDF. Not going to happen. Evolution, provide tools that encourage authors and readers to enrich their content. So one of the things that we realised a couple of years ago is that we tend to think of the thing that we're looking at as being the scientific article. And it's not really. It's the scientific article, or it's not. It's a representation of the scientific article, because there's a whole hierarchy of ideas and thoughts that went into that process of generating that particular piece of work that we're looking at. And the functional requirements for bibliographic records, ontology or framework, is a really nice way of thinking about this. So in the Ferber model, they break things down, and this is a way of classifying things for the purposes of putting them into libraries and that kind of stuff, into work, expression, manifestation, and item. So a work is expressed as an expression. So a work would be sort of the thoughts and background stuff. In fact, actually, I'll just do the next slide. A distinct intellectual or artistic creation, an expression, the specific intellectual or artistic form that a work takes each time it is realised, manifestation, the physical embodiment of an expression of the work, and item, single exemplar or manifestation. So what does that mean in practice? So J.R. Tolkien thinks, ooh, hobbits. And then there are a number of expressions of that idea. Lord of the Rings in English, Lord of the Rings translated into German would be two expressions of his idea or his work of Lord of the Rings. A manifestation could be one of those versions in print or one of those versions in electronic form. So that's a manifestation. And an item, so that's my copy for Lord of the Rings, a physical thing that you can actually pick up. So you've got a whole hierarchy relating back from physical thing in your hand back to Tolkien's original idea. Now in the case of this talk, for example, there's the idea behind the Not a Hamburger, and then there's its expression in terms of this talk or in terms of a paper, and that could be represented in HTML or PDF, and then that could be manifested, that could appear as an item on your computer. And I guess what I think is missing in our current world is a way of joining all of these ideas together. So we have a route forward from idea through expression manifestation to item, but we quite often don't think of it as being these explicit steps. But what we're not very good at as a community are mechanisms of doing this, of giving semantics and identifiers at the point where we're generating these things, and somehow coping with the fact that we've now got multiple representations, each of which are good for different things. PDFs are great for taking on a train to read on your laptop. HTML is good if you're skimming and browsing and doing interconnected stuff. So they both have different affordances, they both have different pros and cons. But we're not very good at joining all of these things up. And we also somehow want to be able to deal with community feedback on all of this stuff. And at the moment it's a bit of a one-way mechanism. And I guess the main sort of thrust of this talk is to say that I think what we need is some way of joining all this back up. And making this an explicit model and an explicit cycle so that all of these different manifestations and items and the underlying work can be linked together so we can play to the strengths of each different format and each different vehicle. So I'm going to show you a tool that we built, we've been building over the past few years. That's our first attempt at doing some of this. So this is Utopia Documents, which is a PDF reader with some extra bells and whistles. So here we take a PDF. Just a normal PDF, nothing special about it. One by Phil Bourne that we used for the Beyond the PDF demos earlier on in the year. So Utopia is a PDF reader, does the normal PDF reading kinds of things, except down at the bottom here, on the previews of the pages, you can see it's added little red dog ears where it's done something interesting to that page. So here, for example, is a table, which is visible in the XML version of this document, but not in the PDF version of it. And what Utopia does is it links those two things together so that the data from the underlying XML that was part of the original work is now editable and visible in the PDF. So you can take that data and plot it and see what the different data points mean, or you can go back and say, all right, well, what would it look like if I plotted a different set of axes against each other? And you know, this is not supposed to be a replacement for Excel or Spotfire, but it's a way of quick and dirty examination of data in tables. That otherwise you'd be cut and pasting those numbers out in a fairly tedious kind of work. Utopia is quite good at spotting where images and figures are in your diagram, so you can sort of flick through them, see what the figures and images are, and then when you select an image from there, it takes you to the appropriate page. Now in this particular case, this is one of the main proteins that's talked about in this paper. And so you can associate that with a particular protein entry in a database and get the three-dimensional representation of that. So it's no longer just a static image inside the PDF. And this is all done in real time. This is not embedded into the PDF in any way. This is done by association. This little speech bubble here on the left, so this is the beginnings of a commentary that's been added to this PDF. Again, not embedded in the file, but just associated with this part of this paper. So anybody reading any variation of this PDF will see this discussion. And this was I was actually talking to the author of the paper to work out which molecule he actually was referring to in that particular page. So one of our colleagues over in the Netherlands has written an interesting plugin for this browser, which is very, very specific to a particular kind of biology, but it illustrates what you can do in terms of breaking out information that's in the PDF and linking it to other sources. So this is about G-protein-coupled receptors, which are a particularly interesting form of protein for biologists, because they're the things that drugs target. But the terminology is confusing. There are lots of different ways of referring to the different elements of this diagram. So there's a coordinate system, essentially, that goes through that snake and that allows biologists to refer to different aspects of that protein. So what this plugin does is it analyzes this text, looks for the species, human, mouse, rat, or whatever, that are being mentioned, and works out where the different terms in this diagram relate, sorry, in this paper, relate to that particular GPCR structure. So these little red things on the left-hand side say this is where Utopia has found something interesting. Those are the words that it's found. If you then click on the words, so that's an A3 receptor, I think, it goes to their database and fetches in real time information about that particular thing, so you can link through and find out the specific details of what you're looking at in a very, very context-sensitive way. Again, it's very, very specific to this particular biological domain. More interesting, if you click on the individual amino acid representations, because there are multiple ways of representing those, Utopia will translate between the different coordinate systems and even give you a diagram of where that particular thing in the paper is anchored in three dimensions in the description of that molecule. And that's all calculated on the fly over in the Netherlands on their GPCRDB database. The other thing you can do is more than sort of generic text mining. So this is using Reflect to find terms of interest in the paper, point at those, and it goes off to various appropriate databases to find definitions of those terms, the structural description of it, homologs, structural homologs, sorry, the protein sequence associated with it. So that's making the contents of the PDF a little bit more amenable, a bit more linked to databases. So what about linking from one article to another? So one of the bugbears of reading a PDF is that it's because it's like a normal paper. If you want to see what the references are, they're at the back, so you've got to flick through to the back of the paper to get at those. And in many reference formats, especially when they're done with those bracketed numbers, you have no idea what that reference is until you've actually looked at what reference 34 actually is. And sometimes you don't want to do that because you'd know that if that was the paper by Blogs et al., that you already know it or you don't want to bother reading it or whatever. So what Utopia can do is, by finding these references in the in-text, it can associate them with bibliographic references in other databases. So here it's found that one, which is this paper here with that title. So instead of having to flick to the last page, I can see that this paper is the metagenome of biogas, something or other. And also because that paper exists out there somewhere in PDF format on the web, if I have the right credentials to allow me to do this, so in this case a subscription to Elsevier's articles, I can just press the Get This Document button and there I go, straight direct to the next PDF that I want to read without having to mess around going through lots of different gateways. So that makes it very straightforward to hyperlink from things that previously had no hyperlinks in it. And you can do this by going, the same kind of thing works in the reference section at the end, so you can point and click at any of the references and get directly to those PDFs. Or to the closest thing that you're allowed to do, whether that's just go to the abstract page or whatever. One of the other nice things that we're able to do now is to take an unstructured PDF, in that there's no metadata describing what these different bits of the PDF are. But because Utopia can actually look at the typographical layout of the paper, it can take a normal PDF and decompose it back into the semantic structure that was underneath it. So in this case, this is the title, there's the authors, that's the abstract, body, heading, subheading, body, pictures, tables, headings, bodies, blah, 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 blah. So what we're able to do with this, references, is, I'm not going to read through this, but is to take a PDF and turn it back into XML. And this is not a great thing for the future, but for the massive pile of legacy stuff, which currently publishers pay a lot of money to manually turn into XML, this is probably a useful tool. So here we have annotated with terms from the SPAR ontologies, the different section titles, text chunks, figure boxes, section titles, blah, 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 blah. And this is, it's heuristic, so it's not perfect, but it's a step in the right kind of direction. Finally, just a couple more little numbers. So there's a project called Cohere, which is run at the Open University, and this is looking at the rhetorical structure and relationship between different articles. So here are claims made in a particular article, which have been identified by the Cohere system, which normally works on HTML, but with Utopia can work on PDF files. And this means that people can annotate different components of the PDF, add rhetorical structure to it, and create sort of argument graphs through the PDF that allows you to link between documents and within documents to identify the rhetorical structure. So this is saying this thing here in this paper supports that thing there in this paper, which is inconsistent with that. I think there's one more. But yes, Mendeley and Open Citations. So again, this is linking from a PDF to other online. Oops, do that again. No. So these are plugins which link Utopia to Mendeley, Open Citations and PubMed. So you can look at recent articles related to this article according to various online databases and go as close to that as your credentials allow you to do. Which one to do next? Related articles from Mendeley. So you can either go through to the Mendeley page and browse Mendeley directly from one particular PDF. Or you can actually just go straight to the PDF. So if you just click on the PDF link there, then it'll open up in Utopia. And then the final one, which is some work that we've been doing with David Shotton, is to link this to Open Citations. So this is an incoming citation graph for this particular article. So the nodes of things that have cited what I'm reading now. Don't really need the outgoing ones because they're in the reference section. So you click on a node, and it will take you to the article that is citing this one, as long as it's in a particular open access subset. So that only works with a certain subset of things. So that's kind of what I wanted to say, really. These are the people involved. Philip McDermott, my colleague's here, so we'll sort of take questions and hopefully get some debate going in a moment. These are the people who have helped out and sponsored this. That's it, so thank you very much. Surprise, surprise.
So, you started off with some of the advantages of the PDF.
Yeah.
So, single container format, readable in the back and printable, and not changeable, I think, were the three main ones.
Not changeable.
Not changeable effectively.
Not changeable because it becomes
part of the site. Yeah, essentially not changeable. It's a bonus. It's not changeable because as soon as you change it, you'll crash. Yeah. It's completely incomprehensible. With Utopia Docs, you've got this very sort of like clever and interactive tool, but that throws away surely all of the advantages that you're claiming for PDF. So it's not readable in the back anymore. All the advantages you've got aren't printable. It's not a single container format anymore because it's going out to third party tools, and it's changeable because the data which you're pointing out to can change.
Absolutely.
So why didn't none of the advantages that you stated for PDF have you maintained?
Not true. Because the underlying PDF is still exactly the same underlying PDF that it was originally. So the main thing, which is that it becomes the minutes of silence, stay exactly as they are. So you're right.
If you ignore all the content.
The underlying document is not changed. So if you look at the underlying document in any other PDF reader, it will be exactly the same PDF that it always has been.
Yeah, but then you're saying, if we ignore all the stuff that you've added, all of the advantages are still there. So why would
you... Well, okay, so one argument for that is that there are hundreds of millions of these things in existence.
What, hundreds of millions of PDFs?
Of articles in PDF
form.
Yeah. So, to a certain extent, we just have to live with the fact that there are lots of them now. Maybe I'm not saying this is a brilliant way of doing it in the future. I'm saying this is a little step towards trying to deal with something that we have now, but point it in the direction of the kind of things we'd like to be able to do. It's fairly clear that the PDF isn't a brilliant format for doing this in the future. No. But there are hundreds of millions of them that we've got to deal with now. And if we just say, we don't care about any of the entirety of science so far, then that's not great. So this is a way of taking the stuff that exists now and trying to add to it some of the things that we would like to see in the future. Hopefully this will eventually make Utopia documents redundant. But I don't think that'll happen in 1 year or 2 years. I think there's a long way before we hit the future vision. And in the meantime, people are going to carry on publishing PDFs until we give them something that has all of the properties, all of the lovely properties that we like of PDFs, and all of the properties that we want of things in the future.
But a lot of it is driven by the reader wants to print off the paper.
Yeah, I mean, of course, so if you printed it onto paper, then we're
still that behavior changes.
I mean, that's something that's very hard to get statistics for, actually, is how many of these PDFs are never read online and are simply downloaded, printed, and probably then just left on a pile in somebody's office to rot.
But I suspect that that's a generation shift where you have people who are comfortable.
Yeah.
How accurate is it all in terms of the actual stuff you're adding onto it?
So it's all heuristic. Well, no, most of it's heuristic. There are a few things that always work. It's very difficult to answer that question because each different bit of it works in a different way. So for example, the G-protein receptor specific stuff is very accurate because it's working in a very, very specific domain.
Do the potential users of this, do they know that there is going to be potential for error?
I suppose we don't make a big deal of that.
I guess in the same way as whenever you use anyone's web service, there's always the caveats that the data you're getting it back or any kind of text mining. You always sort of
most text mining sort of quotes error rates, isn't it?
Some don't. The more techie stuff quotes error rates, and these are just text mining algorithms, which you can find out which ones they are and therefore work out their error rates. So it's maybe it's something that we need to make more of.
You talk about this in a research context.
Mm-hmm.
Predominantly, yeah. I'm just kind of interested to know whether you've engaged in any sort of liaison with some of the textbook publishers, because this has a huge pedagogical capability. And you, for example, you use the Sanger paper to actually deconvolute that paper for an undergraduate that's coming to that sort of paper, albeit traditional methodology for the first time.
Yeah, I mean, it's something that we'd really like to do. We've had early discussions with some so we're writing a book with Wiley. That will be a book that uses this to describe itself, but we would like to look at how this can be applied in a sort of the teaching environment.
Yeah. So I'm thinking of nesting. You could take some of these seminal papers and nest those into a hybrid text.
Yeah. I mean, the other thing that you could use this for, if we had the right framework around it, would be for sort of journal clubs and groups of students to share annotations and share discussions about particular core papers or textbooks that they were looking at. But we haven't done that yet. But the technology sort of the back, the engine is there for it.
This is sort of mind-blowing on lots of levels, but I'd say just, I come from a scientific perspective as a lab notebook vendor sort of thing. This is not about legacy stuff, this is about today's stuff and linking the encapsulated PDF, which is the best definitive form, with the other stuff that you happen to have in the world. And you can't, you have to freeze the PDF for posterity, you can't freeze the rest of the world, so this is a superb middle ground.
That's the position that we took, is that the PDF exists and we're daft to ignore it, and it has some good features that we can't argue with. Can we point in the direction of something newer?
Because I wanted to put those words in your mouth, like freezing it in time. And you use, I think, the term minutes, which was probably apropos.
So that's a term that's borrowed from Jan Balthrop, who described the ARPAP scientific articles as the minutes of science.
But it's not just about papers, any PDF.
Yeah, I mean, I think I mean, so some of this stuff relies. So the structural recognition part of decomposing it back in that relies on it being a scientific article shape thing, but we could reprogram it for any for anything with some structure. So we tested it on a big corpus of stuff, and there was a couple that was failing very badly until we found out that they were actually Chinese takeaway menus that had got into the direct. And it made a bit of a hash of those, but we weren't so fast.
Instrument printouts.
Sorry.
Instrument printouts.
Not one I thought of.
Thousands of those.
Right. Patents were one that we thought of, but
yeah.
Okay.
Can you develop that? You said instrument printouts.
Yeah.
I'm really, go ahead. Just.
Well, we can get the instrument. Oh, well, okay, so we have a lab notebook that people use in industry, lots and lots of people, and a lot of the time they're just printing straight off the instrument into the lab notebook because they have to keep it around because someone told them they had to.
So they don't, presumably the machine could make XML or something structured.
It could do, but
they don't.
It doesn't because either the software doesn't because the instrument vendors are bastards or because it's too old or whatever.
Okay.
So they're just printing out into our database and there it stays.
Right.
This shows structure on cliff.
Right.
I mean, we are already pulling a little bit of stuff out, but this would blow their little minds.
Okay.
Do you have to do curation on the XML that gets produced? Do you not get optical recognition problems?
So the structure structure recognition where it was working out which bits.
No, just taking a PDF to converting to XML. Does that not?
Yeah. So we call that structure recognition.
Oh, sorry,
working out the structure of the document. It's heuristic. So again, it gets it wrong some of the time. What we can't do at the moment, but is in the pipeline, is the interface where it shows you what it's got, and you go, no, you know, that's not a figure caption. That's part of the table or whatever. And the nice thing is that once that's been done by one reader, it's then correct for anybody in the future who reads any variation of that PDF, not your PDF file that you have to send around, but anything that's close enough to the same PDF that our system will recognise it as being the same thing.
Do most of the features that you highlighted require a connection to the internet?
Yes.
All of them?
The structure recognition doesn't. So that can be run in and also the features can also be run as a batch process. They don't have to be done interactively through the GUI as we've shown them here. But yeah, the vast majority of them require. Oh, okay. No, they require connection to meaningful databases. So, for example, we work with we've got a project with Pfizer and AstraZeneca at the moment, connecting it to yes. So they what they're doing is taking Utopia but connecting it to their in-house databases so that they can do this stuff with their special in-house knowledge, in the safe knowledge that nothing that they're looking at is leaking through their firewall into the dangerous outside world.
What about the data behind the figures? Does that require?
Yeah.
Yeah, so that would require either for you to have a copy of the publisher's stuff. Oh, hang on, which
you still have the PDF. You still have to print it out and get into that.
But usually the same routes that you use for getting the PDF. If you trust the routes to get the PDF from the publisher, then you can. Then it's the same route from most of the publishers to get hold of.
So the data behind that one molecule that was rotating, is that not embedded in the PDF?
None of that is embedded in the PDF. So what it does is it recognises the PDF. It goes, oh, it's an instance of a paper called so-and-so by things. Go to the Utopia database and say, what do you know about this paper? Takes those annotations and then superimposes them onto the thing that the user is seeing. So it doesn't touch the underlying paper. And that's both, I think, crucial to the integrity of the science bit and also crucial to the way that Utopia works. So it relies on the underlying PDF being the same thing, not being messed about with.
So you said once one reader has gone through the structural recognition, you store that. Are you storing that? Are you storing the XML of the document on your servers? Are you storing a hash of it?
Oh, so we recognize the article by what we call it a semantic fingerprint, which is a fancy name for a hierarchical series of things to recognize, and that allows it to then associate it with any metadata that has been created by users or algorithms.
So how many?
We don't store any of them.
So how many converted documents do you have in your system?
Not very many, because that bit's pretty new. But we haven't started storing the converted documents yet.
But
we won't be storing the actual documents anyway.
Yeah, we're not storing any PDFs at all.
So yeah,
that's another quite important.
Is that something that you provide an API over?
It will be mentioned. Yeah, so that's important. We don't store the PDF and we don't store the contents of the PDF. We store the annotations on it and pointers to where to put those annotations. So hopefully we won't upset any publishers by doing that.
How are we doing?
A lot of the tables of results are generally like the aggregation of massive data, like gigabytes of data. You'd almost have to publish your data and then those views on your data so that this can look at different views of gigabytes of data.
Yeah, so we don't plan to take all the auxiliary data associated with an article and shove it into the system. But what we can do is link to that. So there are systems like Dryad, which are data repositories, which where the data get given DOIs. And what this can do is, even if that information is not embedded in the PDF, it can recognize that PDF is associated with data in Dryad and say, by the way, the real data is over there. And then that conveniently offloads the problem of storing vast quantities of data onto some other project which specializes in storing vast quantities of data.
You mentioned that the examples of things that you can't do today, but you could if you had better enriched data kind of from the authoring side through the process?
So I think one of the things that was interesting when we started building this is we thought, is there anything interesting that you can do by actually annotating papers, or just building a white elephant? And it turns out every paper we've read, there's something interesting that you want to link to some other artifact or some database or something that tells the story from your point. So the article is the story from the author's point of view. And whenever any other scientist looks at it, they see it from their point of view. And as a way of projecting your point of view on, so here's my angle on this paper. It's much like a really useful way of thinking.
The guy has to slash it.
Not yet. One day.
And availability and timeline of this project?
So everything in the first video is in the version that's free to download now. The stuff that's in the other two videos where it was a whiter background, that's hot off the press, but a couple of months or something like that, probably before we release that. That kind of thing.
Yeah, I think.
So it's 5-2. I'm not sure what happened next. Is it coffee break next?
Is it straight
to the workshop?
Probably 5 minutes is a good
Yeah, so I think unless there's any other burning questions. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.